59.
Who is this?
That's a guy that they call the father of rock and roll.
Oh, yeah?
Chuck Berry. Son of a gun.
Yeah, I heard about him. Now, this position you're standing in here.
My secretary calls it the X shot because my legs are bent in, so.
The have to go to the bathroom look? Same shoes?
Had to be around 58 or 59.
Now, I remember this shot, you know, and a couple of other things right here, too. I guess I was maybe 12 years old when I first saw this, but when I first heard this, for me, there was a kind of separation in your version of rock and roll and everybody else's. It was like, where did this guy ever hear of Beethoven and Tchaikovsky, the lyrics that you were using and everything? Seeing that there was this kind of sophistication in them in regard. It wasn't bebopalula and wapapaluma. It was lyrics going by, like bang, flying by. It wasn't somebody who was just trying to get to the end of the song. It was somebody who was actually, each line was written out.
Trying to tell a story, Robbie.
Yeah.
Really. It came from actually poetry. Poetry portrays a scene or a story, and that's where my lyrics would originate from. Some thought that from it came a story and then proceeded with music, or some riff that reminded me of some situation that brought about a story, you know, mm-hmm. could come from music or come from lyrics.
But poetry, you knew about poetry, you were into poetry.
Very much so.
Really?
Very much so.
Because that's kind of unusual when, in that period, that rebel period and everything. I mean, poetry and sissies kind of went together. So it was a rebel against a rebel.
I don't know. Beatniks were into poetry a lot. I used to see...
That's true.
Yeah, beatniks were into poetry. Yeah. And just before I turn, this picture here was in my first office.
The sex symbol picture.
Maybe I was 19. Young and tender and innocent. You know, but
pretty
here
innocent.
You can see I begin to learn things.
Yes, the innocence is slipping away in this picture.
Yeah, yeah. I began to lose money there.
What is, how come this is burnt
like this? This, from Fran started the scrapbook in 57. We had a fire at the office in, I think, 70. And it burned our scrapbook, and these are survivals of it. And what we have here, my first car that my sister
to the registration
signed for, yeah. The first one was a Ford, the second one was a Plymouth, 33 and 34. And my, what is that, a library card?
Library card, yeah.
And a check stub from National Tea Company, a check stubs. I'm in the money here. I'm making $90 a week here at Fisher Body Auto.
What were you doing there?
Sweeping the floor. That's all we did.
They didn't care nothing about these songs there.
No songs were. No, I was singing for $20.
Who is this? Is this musician union card here?
Oh, I got that in '54 and started learning.
But who is this person's name on here?
Well, that's my name, sort of camouflage that N.
Baron. See.
Chuck Barron, because I wasn't big, and then I didn't want to infiltrate. My dad was a deacon. So you don't want the...
He didn't want you playing this music from the
I didn't want him to know I was playing it, that's for sure. And American Car Foundry, you see, I worked, you know.
Yeah,
you
paid your dues.
At $21 a night playing music, you have to have another job. You know? This is... me here in the Antioch Baptist Church choir. How can you tell?
Well,
we all look alike there.
No, yeah, no, all of them but you.
Okay, and that's in the Antioch Baptist Church choir, and this is my 8th grade graduation. And I don't know where they all, but he's put me on the top row.
In the back row, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm only majored in math. I flunked all of my history.
What is this, you playing the saxophone?
And that was
Chuck Berry playing saxophone, believe it or not.
Well, Johnny Johnson there inspired me to do that.
Old bullet hand Johnny, huh?
He had an air hammer right hand on treble and a dynamited left hand on bass boogie woogie. This here is also the Cosmo here. This was a going away party when Maybelline had, this was about September of 1955, and I left the city on August 15th, 1955, to go to Gleason's Bar, which is here. Gleason's Bar, August 15th, 1955, Cleveland, Ohio, $800 a week behind $21 a night at the Cosmo over there. And just the week before, I was making $32 at the Frolic Bar, $14 at the Three Brothers, $60 with the whole band at the Green Dragon. The Capital Cocktail only paid $15, but Gleason's $800 a week.
That's when you decided, I think this is for me, huh?
This is the way to go. Of course, you know who this guy is. And Robbie, this is Muddy Waters behind the mic.
Yes, it is.
And this is a disc jockey in Chicago. He's pretty big, named Al somebody. But this is Leonard Chess.
Yep.
In his glory.
Mm-hmm.
With a hit maker on his hands. And this was my first and only manager.
Oh, yeah?
400-pound Teddy Reig, you know.
Uh-huh.
Who saw fit to slip $50 of $150 PC into his pocket. And I have to know for a fact, because I dated the owner to the club, and she happened to mention that it was $150 PC. And I says, oh, yes, you know. So now I know where my manager clipped. You learn all these things as you go.
So, and you've never had a manager since?
No. I couldn't get rid of him until I lay dead, until he did sign one of my checks and endorsed it, rather. And
mm-hmm.
Then I asked him for that or release.
I remember the first time I ever saw you on one of these Alan Freed shows. It was in Toronto, and you're coming through. And it was a big thing. You were by far the biggest star on the show. The show begins, and you're the first act that goes on. I thought to myself, I mean, even at that age, I thought, this is strange.
Well, listen, you know,
how come Barry wants to go on first?
Well, not, it's not wants, it's where they put you.
So, all right, well then,
I didn't know
let's
that
cut
the star
ahead,
was
let's
on
cut
the
ahead in time, and a year later, I come, I see an Alan Freed show playing. The show opens, Chuck Berry plays first. I think, what is this? Why did you insist on opening the show? I mean, I could see in that stage, they said, okay, Chuck, we want you to go on first. Then you had like two or three more hits after that. I go and see the show, you're still playing first. What was the...
Okay.
There had to be a method to this madness.
Okay, I was a good opening act. And it didn't matter to me, and then...
Because everybody was arguing over, I'm going to close the show,
I'm
going to close the show.
But Chuck Berry... Because Chuck Berry didn't know that the star closes a show until maybe 2 years into his career, when he began to look at the money that the stars got and why they close, then he wanted to close, you know. And still, really, it doesn't matter today whether I close or open the show, because I'm going to try to rob everybody of the starship.
Yeah, that's right. I thought... Yeah, there's got to be something to this. It's something I thought...
It doesn't matter, really.
I got to understand, you know, there must be some kind of special thing that he's onto that nobody else is getting or something in this.
Here, if you go on first and you're not responsible for a riot if it happens, or you get and you're finished. And if the thing breaks up on the third act, you still finish, and you're... remember, it's a livelihood also.
Did you stick around and watch the rest of the shows?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, because you had to ride the bus to the next gig. And then not knowing that the better position and the better status of a artist to play last, you know, last impression last, I didn't know these things, you know. In fact... When I went to Paramount, my first New York gig, I didn't know that you changed. You know, you do five, six shows
mm-hmm.
a day. I didn't know that you changed. And the one suit that we had was satin and had the impressions of seersucker. You know, seersucker, you old enough to know what a seersucker is? and it was wrinkled, and you know, and I found out that they had irons and things to do your clothes up also, and people there to sew your clothes, all these new things, you know. And really, until I got to the Paramount, I didn't know that you guys had a room to yourself, you know, like a dressing room.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is almost like home. All you have to have is a car and your guitar, and you can make it in the world. You're mm-hmm. just constantly playing gigs. You have to have one every night, you know, have somewhere to sleep.
When, how come you did so much work with Alan Freed? I mean, you must have been in every one of those Alan Freed movies.
Well, now.
All of those shows. I mean, did you have a, you know, a good relationship with the guy? I mean, did you have a, you know, a good business relationship with him, or did you really think that he was...
No, I tell you, I had a good relationship with him, my record company.
Oh, yeah.
And this was
when
Paola was born, and the record company gave, as I understand it, the record company gave the record to Alan Freed, and it was either jumping from Cleveland to New York, whatever station it was. And, of course, then, with a little compensation, you played a record. And I imagine that's what he got, because he played it, and it was heard. Now, the record might have had a little punch to it also, you know. And I imagine it did by living all these years. And that's the way he is affiliated, you know.
He had that kind of power in those days, huh?
Oh, yeah, record. And anybody yeah. did who had national
mm-hmm.
wow. And so Leonard Chess was tied in with him,
uh-huh.
among other ties.
Who's this?
That's my wife, Tamara. And this is 1956.
Wow.
At home. And they told me to pose at the piano. And this is the front of that house.
Uh-huh.
And this is the famous pink Cadillac that used to... get tickets of itself. They say they wasn't giving me a ticket, but the car was weaving in and out of the room. This is St. Louis Lambert Airport, when it was a small airport. This is a picture of...
the young lovers.
This is in courtship year. 6 months we courted. And this is Ingrid. She's done an album with me, my daughter. And
mm-hmm.
this is... Melody, my second daughter, and here they are in school. And display of Sepia magazine, courtesy Sepia.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah, here's one of those movies.
Yeah. And this is Rock, 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 the first movie I did, and it was with Alan Freed. I don't know what the figure on it. It's something like $600. I didn't know it. A lot of money to me then.
Roll over Beethoven. How far did you go in school? I mean, that's what made me think when I was a kid. I thought, God, this guy must have gone to school or something. He's talking about Tchaikovsky and using these kind of lyrics.
Okay, I went to through high school.
Uh-huh.
And a bit of college, but not general education. It was on cosmetology I went to college. Only for cosmetology, hairdressing. Coiffure.
Really?
Coiffure. Oh, yeah.
This, on so many of the songs that you played, this position on the guitar, which I'd studied very carefully as a child, just that the size of your hands and everything, but that ding 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 ding, where did that come from? Where was your first? You said that everything you ever did, you heard somebody else do first. Where did you hear that first?
It was Boogie Woogie, number one. And, I would say it came from mimicking the figure on a piano of uh-huh. Boogie Woogie. 1, 5, and 6. 1, 5, and 6.
Right.
1, 5, 6 in rhythmic progression. And you can do the same thing on the guitar. Much more easy, I found.
Yeah.
So that's a background for, it's a constant background. You can sing to it. Yeah.
Did you ever hear anybody do ding ding
ding ding ding ding on the guitar?
Before you did it?
On the piano, I heard it.
No, that's not what I said on the guitar.
Yeah. Well, no, actually, because okay. the guitar players I listened to were Charlie Christian and T-Bone Walker, who
mm-hmm.
who did most of his figures in the treble strings, and Muddy, one string, you know, and...
Jimmy Reed did it kind of slow, you know, doom, 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 you know.
Yeah.
But it wasn't rhythmic. It wasn't it's not the same thing. And you did it over three strings, you know, when you add that fourth to the note, too. And don't mean to get
but I mean, technically, musical, carried away. Yeah, 4-1 and 5 is a boogie bass. And adding a 6 is just gives you somewhere to go to come back to the bass, you know, after talking to this now. But I imagine I would have heard it, but not. I don't think I've heard it fast, though, other mm-hmm. than on the piano. You know, that slow rhythmic blues is, you don't need to, you know, you need to go anywhere, because sometimes it's just tonic,
yeah.
you know. But
who were the guys, I mean, for me, it was you. For you, who was it that when you were getting into music, saying, boy, I want to do what this guy does?
We're in a whole different ballgame, because my first inspiration was Nat Cole in high school.
Mm-hmm.
You see, by nature, see, I'm a lover, you see.
I see.
But I never
get
a chance to love. No, we're back in high school now. I'm innocent, you see. And no girlfriend, you know, because I always had a gift to gab, and I always did like comedy, you know, and poetry. Comedy is too silly for love. Poetry is too serious. So I was left out in my exploitation, you know. Until I got into show business, and I found that you don't go after your inspirations, they come to you, you know. And incidentally, that was very lucrative in the opening the shows, too.
But what are we talking about? Wait a minute. where do we go?
You thrash.
I was asking you, Nat King Cole, that's it.
Yeah.
He was the heavy for you,
yeah,
huh? The
yeah.
big one.
Yeah, but without a voice, I could not come near Nat Cole, but it didn't keep me from mimicking or liking his music.
Mm-hmm.
Then there was, the piano is by nature one of my loves, and I listened to Albert Ammons, Pete Johnson, and that put me on guitar after the All Men's Review, and this guy backed me. Then I wanted to play guitar, and I can walk and sing and talk. So those, Louis Jordan's guitarist, Carl Hogan,
mm-hmm.
Was the inspiration for most of my solos. Carol, Johnny B. Goode, Rollover Beethoven, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da, and
is he the first guy that played that?
That played something like that.
Yeah,
that played something like that. He had it in
the center.
He had something like this in the center of a solo, and I opened my song with it. And Robert Beethoven, after it hit, later on Johnny B. Goode hit, later on Carol hit with the same solo.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a little difference in the figure,
oh, yeah.
you know, but then same principle. Start at the top tonic with 0-5, or 8-5,
mm-hmm.
and then get away. Do your changes and move on out. Exploit your lyrics and keep your rhymes and wind up with a break and out. And you get an applaud, do it again.
That's kind of like the Ten Commandments of rock and roll or something.
Tell me about it. Mm-hmm.
Was there anybody, anything that you had heard before you did Maybelline that said, wait a minute,
sure.
I know what to
sure.
do now.
Sure, as a matter of fact, I have stood on the stage in the Cosmopolitan and thinking of how I could produce something like Little Richard's Tutti Frutti, which was really sizzling at the time. And, you know, the main thing about it here, like Little Richard, sometimes I couldn't understand what they were saying, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went into writing Maybelline, I had a desire and an intention, you know, to speak the words of a song real clear, because Nat Cole taught me that, you know. Nat Cole had a diction,
uh-huh.
I think, that was just superb, you know.
Uh-huh.
Pretend you're happy when you're blue. And you could hear every word, his S's, T's, P's, and G's.
Mm-hmm.
But when you're singing like Roll over Beethoven, roll over Beethoven. You got to speak distinct in order to get your message out.
Especially with the number of words that you use.
Yeah,
you
well,
know? I mean, the words are flying
boogie,
by.
Boogie is eight to the bar. So if you have a word, if you have two words with four syllables, you got to say them within a bar.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of Little Richard, there's the little devil right there.
Yeah. What was that?
This is the one here.
That's pretty.
Rock and roll music.
That same suit went for about a year because it was the only picture the publishers had.
School days. This thing about writing about, I mean, I don't know how old you were at this
trip. Well, I was 29 when Maybelline came out. So school days was maybe a year and a half.
You were 29 when Maybelline came out.
Yeah, I had a house and a car and two children.
But how, what made you think to write songs about up in the morning and off to school?
Because when I went out on the road, I found that over half of the audience was teenagers, kids in school. So if you're, whoever you're singing, you play what the people want, you know. Sing about them and they'll listen to you. In nightclubs, I have nothing to sing but Wee Wee Hour. I had two records when I first sang. Wee Wee Hours, and then I'd sing some Muddy Waters and what have you, whatever the, Down the Way Where the Lights Are Gay, you know, school kids don't know anything about Jamaica.
Uh-huh.
They know something about school days.
Mm-hmm.
They know something about Roll Over Beethoven and Boogie Woogie or dance. They know when they feel something they can dance off of. So that's why I, you know, I stuck to school. And the record, sometimes Leonard Chess would speed up the record. Look, I was 29 years old when I recorded these records, you know. And I'm sure I sound like a father because I was a father. But he would speed the record, record it on wax up, and make me sound like a teenager. And then when the people,
really?
The guys hear it.
This is the first I've ever heard.
Yeah, when the guys hear the record.
It would speed it up and make you sound like a teenager?
It's a higher voice, you know.
Uh-huh. With these consecutive hits, how long did that go on? Up to when?
My greatest years were from 55 when I started with Maybelline, which was a smash, through to, I'd say, 4 years. 55, 59. Then it began to taper off because then, at that time, the hippie era came. The mini skirt era was coming in.
And, in the 60s.
Oh, yeah, beautiful years of the city. You were there as a teenager yourself. And, you know, nobody, music went up on the wall in what do they call it, liquid showings and smoking became popular. And I don't mean cools. And sexual revolution was mm-hmm. coming in, and but, many changes, long hair.
But what did this have to do with you no longer making records? Or you said it went from...
I joined the fiesta. I was wanting to live, too. Don't forget, now, I'm 35 now.
Right.
And still liking the way that the society is moving into this freedom of
You're
this,
enjoying the sexual revolution.
wouldn't you? And however, I tell you one thing, though. I never, I was old enough to lay off of smoking. And of course, I never did get into drugs, you know, but.
You never did any drugs in your life?
You know, and I don't care who believes.
No.
That doesn't believe me.
No, I know, but you yourself have never done any drugs in your life.
No, I wouldn't. And advise all others to, if they're on it, try and get off, because I don't think they can, you know, but try anyway. But I've just seen too many of my friends go here. Uh-huh. Joplin, Hendrix, you name it. Ev Presley, you know, some of the greats have gone down the drain. And I'm feeling fine without it. So, I mean, the other vices must not be too strenuous, you might say. So here I am.
So what happened? All of these hits are going bang, 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 bang. And then besides the sexual revolution coming into focus, what happened? Did you run out of ideas? Did you stop recording? What did you do?
I tell you what I did. I was continually being called to do dates. And my as you see on these little charts, the fee for the dates constantly rose. For instance, when I had my problems with the, when I had my problems with the Indian girl, I was away for almost a couple of years, you know. I went away making $1,200 a night. When I came back, the Beatles had come to America, and my salary then was $2,000 right from being away. Now, if this is America, you stay away somewhere, you come back, you get more pay. Then when I realized this, you know, and believe me, I came back with Nadine. I came back with no particular place to go.
Was the world, was it different then?
Oh, yes, it's different.
Besides the Beatles and music, you know, evolving a little bit and everything. Mm. For you yourself,
having
been like this huge star playing everywhere in the world and hits popping and inspiration, all of a sudden, bingo, you run into a brick wall, your life changes.
No, let me tell you.
Okay.
Life didn't change. I don't know, are you calling a brick wall when I went away?
Yeah.
Okay, when I went away, number one, and finished high school. Number two, I took 5 business courses. Well, here, I took accounting, I took business management. When I came back, I found out what I had, which was a corporation, was. I knew what it was. I knew what accounting was. I'm better qualified.
That's what I wanted to ask you. I mean, I didn't want to bring it up if you didn't want to talk about it, but I wanted to ask you how you utilized
these are the ways. Plus, it's easy to count my blessings as well as it is count my misfortunes. And mm-hmm. I did. And I weighed them. And I came back out quite a better... in a better position mm-hmm. to handle life. And don't forget, I had a little bank account, too, that mm-hmm. I wanted to maintain. So I wrote on, and I wrote...
Did you write any music?
And I'm telling you, I came out with Nadine and no particular place to go, and it went a little place. As time went on, I wrote maybe something that was heard. I can't think of just now. But finally, in 70, which was 6 years later, here's Ding-a-ling, smash hit. Recorded in England, you know. Okay, and I says, oh, it made a comeback, made a comeback. Well, frankly, other than my absence, it never left. I'm heavy into real estate because that's the only place I see to spend money, invest money, that is, lucratively, and not exploiting my wealth, but it is something to, I don't have someone to take care of it, and that takes quite a bit of your time to take mm-hmm. care of a business that you're running. So I have the investment company that I run real estate, and then I have Chuck Berry Music that runs my music, you know. Now back to Ding-a-ling. At this time, Ding-a-ling was a hit. I bought more property, and I'm into about 3 different people now, a businessman, a musician, and you say a writer, they say a father of rock and roll, and quite busy. Now someone's trying to make me a movie star. I don't know. I might make it.
You might make it.